And to all of you watching, you can send in your questions to the speakers. There's going to be an email popping up on your screen where you can email Eva here that will find some questions for us to answer if we have time. And do keep the questions short and to the point. This section is called Global Voices of Experience. And what better way to start than with one of the most experienced voices out there, a grand old man within circular economy. Walter Stahl founded the Product Life Institute in Switzerland in 1983. It is the oldest consultancy devoted to sustainable strategies and policies in Europe. He's written a book, A User's Guide to Circular Economy, and if you happen to read Norwegian, you can download it free at the SINTEF webpage. But we are proud to have him here live via link. So, Mr. Walter Stahl, we're proud to welcome you to our stream and looking forward to hearing your tale of circular economy. Are you there with us?
Yes. Thank you very much for the introduction. Good morning to all. I'm going to answer three questions. The first one is, where have we been? Circularity has always been the principle governing nature. Circular society of making the best out of the accessible resources is as old as mankind, as is a circular economy of scarcity and even poverty, of use it up, wear it out, make it do or do without. A century ago, a material circular economy started when some industrialized regions had accumulated sufficient stocks of manufactured objects to fulfill the basic needs, reaching markets near saturation. Where are we now? 75 years ago, the nuclear bomb over Hiroshima triggered the Anthropocene. Scientists were now able to create light brighter than a thousand suns, synthetic materials with incredible properties, such as plastic polymers, chemicals, pharmaceuticals, metal alloys. But society overlooked the fact that these materials are unknown to nature and incompatible with its circularity, and therefore imply a moral liability of producers. In industrialized regions, we now have an abundance of manufactured objects, which enables us to create a circular economy which depends on the motivation of owner-users to look after and care for their belongings. My focus is on these regions where the local owner-users are in control to maintain value and utility, function and performance of objects by keeping infrastructure and buildings in good repair, and by extending the service life of goods through reuse, repair, refill, reprogram, remanufacture service activities, which create skilled jobs locally, reduce waste volumes at home and resource extraction abroad, and preserve the water and energy consumed and CO2 emitted in manufacturing. Globally, circularity can be described as three parallel worlds. Nature with biocycles that are governed by nature's ability to reproduce and absorb its circularity. The manufactured materials world that is governed by man and economic actors, factors, monetary values, and the concept of property. The immaterial world with the invisible cycles of caring and liability governed by decision makers, political framework conditions, and our own behavior and motivation. Where are we going? Economic actors will continue to apply techno-commercial innovations in the area of R, and scientific discoveries will improve the area of D, such as microbial organisms that digest plastic waste and mutant bacterial enzymes, reducing plastic bottles to chemical building blocks. But the biggest breakthroughs will come from the international highly competitive research into circular material and system sciences. Researchers are picking up the challenges of circular physics, circular chemistry and circular metallurgy. Early examples of circular energy are geothermic energy, energy savings, energy recovery, fuel cells using green hydrogen, such as Norway's new express ferries. Early examples of circular metallurgy have been described in literature. There are many examples of circular chemistry, PDK polymers with low energy and water consumption that are 100% recoverable as pure monomers for reuse, self-destroying polymers for drug delivery and scaffolds for 3D printing, carbon capture and utilization. Scientists are also making progress in biochemistry and synthetic biology, which hopefully are of a circular nature. To summarize, circular economy is about economics, innovation, and competitiveness, and will continue to be a mixture of local, regional, and international opportunities. It is up to us to seize these opportunities. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Mr. Stahl. Do you have, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, great. So you've been working on circular economy for almost 40 years. Is there something new now that makes you more optimistic?
I think the big progress is that people and politicians and companies are waking up to the opportunities and the chances and risks of the circular economy. Now, of course, COVID-19 has suddenly changed the whole economic game, but it has also shown that the Karl Marx's old fascination with productive work has now been supplemented with essential services. Because during COVID-19, we realized that the important thing for society is less the productive work than the essential workers in hospitals, the plumbers, all the maintenance people, the bus drivers that are not productive, but they are essential. So I hope that economists are reviewing their script and recognize the potential for a new economy, a resilient society in the circular economy.
Thank you. And after you've recognized the potential, what is now left as the biggest hurdles or barriers to take this to scale?
I think, as always, in any change, dramatic, radical change, the biggest hurdles are the lock-in technology and the stranded capital. So if you take the airline industry or the car industry, if we now tell them that hydrogen fuel cells are the future, then we have a huge problem with all the new investments in producing battery factories. And of course, the whole diesel engine thing is probably a thing of the past. So governments have a tendency to keep a high inertia. They are safer, they want to save the old jobs, and so they will normally do everything they can to support existing industries rather than radically change and put all their money in the future industries, because we can see where the future is going, The low carbon, low waste future, and that needs very different investments.
Thank you very much. Thank you. We're moving on. And I just wanted to remind you all that you can send in your questions to Eva, who's sitting here and receiving emails. And her email address should pop up on your screen. our next international expert is actually here with us in this room. Mr. Edgar Hatrich, it's the International Chair of International Ecology at the Norwegian University of Science and Technology. He leads the university's research on circular economy, and he's also leading the work on resource efficiency and climate change at the International Resource Panel. And he's here to give us a short presentation on of how do we use materials on a carbon budget.
Yes, thank you. Let's see. You can hear me? Thank you. So let's go to my presentation, please. I can see it on my screen, but in the back. No, that this is the wrong presentation. So it should say material use within the carbon budget. All right, thank you. So I'm here to talk about the study that was done by the International Resource Panel. And it was entitled Resource Efficiency and Climate Change. And so I'm going to connect those two issues to each other. When we talk about the circular economy, we usually focus on materials. And that's right. Materials are very important. In fact, the importance of materials has grown in the past decade. So over two decades, the importance of materials in causing greenhouse gas emissions has increased from 15% of the global emissions to 23%. And the most important materials in terms of greenhouse gas emissions are metals, construction minerals, and followed that by that with smaller shares, plastic and rubber and wood products. So if we want to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, we'll have to look at these big flows of materials, iron and steel being the most important one, cement being the second most important one within these categories. And actually reducing these emissions is not that easy. Because especially for iron and steel and cement, it's not only the energy use. Emissions of CO2 are part of the process of removing oxygen or of making available the raw material from its mineral form. Now, there was a really good news at the beginning of this week, and maybe you haven't heard about it. But in Sweden, the Swedish Prime Minister opened a pilot project for producing steel with the help of hydrogen instead of carbon in Luleå. This is a really important step forward. So here they will be using hydrogen instead of carbon to reduce the iron ore. This is called the hybrid project. So we can see that the decarbonization of material production is in the works. But unfortunately, this is not going to be so quick. Let's see here. I'm having problems controlling wherever the computer is. to move that forward, maybe I need a new battery. The plan of the hybrid consortium is to have a commercial technology ready by 2035. So another 15 years of demonstration plans and technology improvement until they feel this could be ready to scale up. Now, why is that time horizon important? Well, we have set ourselves a very ambitious goal in terms of reducing greenhouse gas emissions from about 50 billion tons of CO2 equivalents per year down to zero within the short time horizon. The global carbon budget is the amount of CO2 that we can still put into the atmosphere until we reach a certain level of global warming. And politicians in Paris have agreed that the goal should be 1.5 degrees, or well below 2 degrees at least. Now, if you take those 1.5 degrees, we're talking about the carbon budget between between 250 and 500 billion tons, right? So we need the emissions reductions that we have seen during the COVID crisis. And to sustain that rate for decades, right, in order to get down there. And most scenario models show that this we will only be able to stabilize if we start taking CO2 out of the atmosphere again through carbon capture processes. Where do I have the pointer? So there is this area here where large amounts of greenhouse gases would be removed from the atmosphere, either by plants or through industrial facilities. And this is a very expensive process. So I personally think that it's fairly unrealistic. Now, if we compare that carbon budget with the time that is required to decarbonize material production, we see that focusing on material production is not the only thing we need to do. We also need to focus on material use. We need to reduce the amount of primary materials that we produce in order to reduce the greenhouse gas emissions from material production, at least until we have these green material production processes available. And this is why the G7 group of countries commissioned the International Resource Panel to study opportunities of material efficiency and their contribution to climate change mitigation. And this is the study that we presented to the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change at its annual meeting in Madrid last December, and I have the summary for policymakers here. In this study, we looked throughout the life cycle of products at measures that could reduce greenhouse gas emissions by reducing materials use. So the first question was, can you design products that just are lighter, that use less materials? Can you substitute carbon-intensive products with products that cause less greenhouse gas emissions, or even bind carbon in the product, like wood as a construction material? Can you have higher yields, that means less waste in the production process? Can you have a more intensive use of products so that you need fewer products to provide the same service? Can you extend the lifetime of products in order for the product to provide more services over a longer time horizon? And then can you recover either the components or the materials at the end of life of those products? So we investigated all of that, and we focused on cars and on buildings, residential buildings, because these are very important products overall, and we heard that already. So you can see here that for the G7 countries, just a cleaning up of the energy mix would bring emissions down substantially. But if you add the material efficiency measures, we have a further 35% reduction of greenhouse gas emissions that's possible. And for India and China, there is a much larger share of the emissions connected to buildings that is from producing the materials because there is less heating and operational energy requirements, and there is more new construction that is required. We also expect these to go down given changes in the economy and the greening of the energy supply. And there are even larger savings available through material efficiency measures. Now, within the housing sector, the largest gains in terms of material efficiency are through more intensive use. That usually means multifamily houses instead of single family houses. That means that there's a certain limit to the size of apartments. That means a better organization of the space indoors. However, also other measures like using wood for construction materials and enhancing end-of-life recovery are prospective. They deliver emissions reductions. Overall, these measures are a contribution, but they are not sufficient to bring us all the way to 1.5 degree. gaps. So in the end, we will need the hybrid process and similar process of clean material production if we want to achieve the carbon emissions. And I'm having problems focusing again or switching forward. I thought the Deloitte study brought up some nice issues in terms of the policies that are necessary in order to get the circular economy and material efficiency going. And what we really found in our policy review that it's a problem that there's this disjoint between climate policy and materials policy. And a lot of the materials policy focuses only on landfill diversion, that means minimizing solid waste, whereas we think that you actually need to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. You need to measure the reduction of greenhouse gas emissions. You need to evaluate policies based on how much they reduce greenhouse gas emissions. And so we found that there is carbon taxes, which are really important, but that there are a number of other measures that also can contribute, like building certification systems that award the reuse of materials and the use of wood. And other renewable materials. Green public procurement, we've heard that before. Virgin material extraction tax. There is a reduction just of subsidies provided for primary resource production and external costs that are not priced today, and then recycled content mandates. So those are issues that we actually found important. I'm glad to say that Achim Steiner, the head of the United Nations Development Program, who was there at the launch of the report, has promised that these measures will be part of the nationally determined contributions that UNDP helps developing countries design. And so he wants to take material efficiency into climate policy. And I think that's a great success for the International Resource Panel. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, and it's also great input for our minister that has to integrate both the climate strategies and the circular strategies. Yes. So, we've talked about money and carbon and materials, but just like Sintef highlighted earlier, the circular economies is also about people. And Marek Harstoff, he is an economist in the Green Jobs Program at the International Labour Organization. He asks, how do we transition to a circular economy while maximizing jobs, minimizing losses, and ensuring the shift is just and for everyone? And we hope you have the answers, Marek.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes. Welcome.
Thank you very much. Yeah, as my previous speaker, you indicated, when we talk circular economy, we talk material. We talk material extraction, and we talk nowadays increasingly climate change. However, my presentation is about better circular economy policies, which talks about the people which need to enact all these measures that have been discussed earlier. Let me see how I can switch my slide. So this is what we talk about. It's global material extraction, and it is increasing. This is why we all talk about circular economy. But at the same time, we have unemployment, inequality, poverty rising. On purpose, I didn't include newest estimates from my organization, the ILO, of the COVID crisis, 400 million additional jobs lost just in the crisis, because it is not related to the crisis. Poverty and unemployment is increasing even without the crisis. So as we speak to the non-converted, those in fact who are taking the action, presidents, ministers in economy and planning, if, in a sense, being provocative, if we don't achieve social and economic outcomes, as we know from the climate debate, there is no way that these circular economy policies will be enacted. So when we talk about transport, electricity, buildings, industry, agriculture, and waste, we need to think about the transition of those economic sectors which have positive social and employment outcomes. Otherwise, these policies will hit a wall before being enacted by the winning party of a government, notably in the developing country context. So we need policies that maximize jobs, that protect those who may lose jobs, and that reduce poverty and inequality in general. So first, policies need to be evidence-based. So we did study in a couple of research papers. We did study the effect of circular economy policies on social and economic impacts. And I'm not sure if I see the room down in your hall, and I'm not sure if I see Kirsten from the back. Hi, Kirsten. She's part of the team who did the analysis. So first, you need to find out the total overall impact. That is crucial to policymakers to understand the overall scale. So just looking at the job creation potential under certain scenarios, I will not go into detail, we believe that 78 million jobs can be created. However, if you look up to 2030, 71 million jobs may be destroyed in other sectors of the economy. So you need to go further down into the occupational level and the industries they work to find out which jobs can be reallocated and absorbed in the same industry with a little bit of reskilling and upskilling, and which jobs, here these are 22 million jobs, which may completely be lost because they are in occupations that are not directly being replaced, into new training, a completely new curricula which need to be developed. So just in terms of the occupations, to give you a gist of it, 15.6 million sales workers are leading the circular economy scenario in our case, whereas recycling and refuse workers, as you've seen down the scale, are not the ones that are probably sought by policymakers. So this is of utmost importance to understand the full a picture of the labor market transition that a circular economy will bring. You need to further dig down after you have an overall picture. You need to further dig down into, as I mentioned, the skills required for the training systems to adopt. But then also you need to look into the job change by gender. Here, for once, there is a positive picture without accompanying policies, as we have seen, sales workers are typically dominated by women. So the gain for women is larger than the loss, for example, for men. Now, as a conclusion, I think the first is you need to study at your national level. No, the global study will not help you to understand. Each and every country is different. The first picture I've shown on the slide is from a dump site in Nairobi. This circular economy policies are very different than, say, in Norway, in your country. So it need to be based on national data and needs, looking at the sustainable development goals at large and what objectives you have in your national development plans. You need, obviously, the capacity to run your own model. There's a training guide we developed through a network called the Green Jobs Assessment Institutions Network, which helps to build that capacity. And only once you have the results, which I just sketched above from the research, you would need to enact policies which may or may not include, but some from our experience come up quite often, notably fiscal tax reforms. We know that the tax burden is on labor. In economic sense, it doesn't make any sense to tax labor because this is what an economy wants to achieve, while emissions are basically for free. Negative externalities are very low in terms of the overall tax revenue of government. So fiscal tax reform, skills obviously is crucial to create those jobs and occupations you require in the new circular economy scenario. Enterprise development, as well as social protection measures, as I had indicated, potentially 71 million jobs may be lost in a transition. Obviously, if you don't have policies which are at the same time enacted as the circular economy policies, then you will face the unions going to the street or other public movements, which will hinder all these policies, because people are right to want to save their jobs from any policies that destroy their income. And finally, the work conditions must be decent, as in many countries of the developing world, this is not the case. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Marek. Are you still with us?
Yeah, I would not leave straight the room.
Okay, just one question. Because Susie from SINTEF presented earlier about job creation in Norway. And what kind of responsibilities do we have in Norway for supporting the developing countries when jobs are moved from the factories in the production countries towards our service industry in the sales markets?
Yeah, I think the look at your export-import statistics. This gives you the answer, and then link it to the global economy, where you will find as we speak, I think the Kenyan government is the first government in Africa to have a bilateral trade agreement with the US administration. You may have seen in the news that the US wants to force Kenya to reopen its plastic market, notably for single-use plastics, and the ban of the previously enacted ban on bags, on plastic bags. And also, the material that you use in Norway is sourced. I don't have the statistics, but you will find it in SINTEF, I believe, will be sourced in a majority from other countries, as well as you will export your waste, including obviously the emission waste, to developing countries. Now, it's not about materials as such, which I believe is important, but behind the materials and the waste that you export, there are the people working in those industries. Not say if you stop importing stuff from Africa, obviously jobs will be impacted in Africa. If you export your waste, as we have seen in 2018 when China stopped to want to become the dump site of the world, it started to fill up in Indonesia, in other countries around the world. And people are not only working on these dump sites in the developing country context, but they also suffer just from the pollution because it is dumped on their ports and their cities and their clogs, the streets and so forth. So the simple answer is, yes, Norway has a responsibility to look at the supply chain of its imports and the people and its working conditions behind these material extraction and imports, as well as a responsibility to clean up its forward linkages of waste which is dumped into the developing world. Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you for joining us. So, this is just getting more and more complex. It's money, and it's carbon, and it's material, and it's people. So how do we tie this all together for regional roadmaps? Our next international expert is Ladea Godina Koshir. She is recognized as an engine of circular economy in the Adriatic region. She's the founder of Circular Change Platform. And then she was asked to chair the European Circular Economy Shareholder Platform. So we wanted to ask Ladea, how do we get everyone involved in creating a roadmap, a comprehensive roadmap? And how do we get people to commit and walk the talk? Ladea, are you with us?
Yes, hello, can you hear me?
Yes, we can. We're looking forward to hear your presentation.
Okay, so hello to everyone. I'm really pleased that I can be with you today, at least virtually, because last year I have visited Norway 3 times and being engaged in your super interesting activities regarding circular economy. So congratulations first for the event. I have learned a lot during the day already. So yes, I will tackle the journey that is related to circular economy roadmap, as well as try to give you a perspective where we see opportunities for further collaboration between Norway and European countries. But let me start with a quote that says, life can only be understood backwards, but it must be lived forwards. Today we have heard a lot about the reporting, and congratulations on your circularity gap report as well. So all that is explaining us the life as it used to be. But now we are here to imagine the life ahead of us. And having now this COVID crisis on one side and at the same time climate crisis is here, it is really so important to be able to think out of the box, really to use our creative potentials, to be innovative and to include science. So exactly what SINTEF is doing with activities is what is so much needed. And I sincerely hope that there is a lot of support, not only in Norway, but a lot of understanding in other European countries, how important it is that we join forces right now. So on this circular short journey that is ahead of us, I would like to address 5 points. One is related to that there is no universal recipe how to make your circular economy roadmap a reality, neither how to make your circular transition a reality. We have heard that each country is unique, and it does not mean that exchange of knowledge is not needed, but it is important to understand what is the basis of the economy, of the society, of culture, and to build upon that. The second is that the process is more important than the document as such. We have heard about the documents that have been produced, and I'm sure that the engagement of all stakeholders on this way of preparing those documents and reports gave a lot of insights where the potential lies, who are those people that are already front runners, which organizations are mature enough to lead the transition. So that is what counts, the process. The third, engagement of circular economy change makers is of crucial importance, because as always, it is hard to be a pioneer, no matter whether you are an individual, an NGO, or a big company. Because opening the doors for something new is also does mean that you are taking the risk and that you are not understand at the very first stage. So with circular economy transition, what we can now track for a few years is exactly that, that without front runners and then the support for those front runners, the change cannot happen. The fourth thing is bridging a top-down and bottom-up approach. So a lot is happening, of course, on the side of policy making, decision making. But we have heard several times today what a crucial role citizens play, because we as citizens are taking decisions on our daily basis. We understand daily life. And therefore, this link between our habits, our values, our way of thinking and acting should be aligned with the policies, measurements, taxation, everything, because these are not two separate words. So I'm encouraging this to bridge those two arenas, to say so. And the fifth message is to orchestrate this systemic and holistic transition. It is so complex and sometimes so complicated that it is really of crucial importance that it is orchestrated and that the space is enabled where we can express our needs, our interests, and then agree on that, how to move forward jointly. So now during this crisis, I would like to quote also Ursula von der Leyen, the president of EU Commission, because she so nicely pointed out during this pandemic times that we are all together here in Europe and that we shall do everything and everyone should do whatever he or she can to protect lives and livelihoods. And the previous speaker nicely pointed out that it is about people, it is about jobs, it is about our well-being. So talking about circular economy and everything what is in this package is directly related to our well-being and to the achievement of the sustainable development goals. So these are not different stories. I always say it is about the agreement we have on sustainable development goals. It is about green transition, now green recovery, and circular economy is the best possible tool to move things forward. As you're all familiar with, we have now the European Green Deal, and this is a kind of compass. I will not go into the details, but would like to point out once again, what is written here is that mobilizing research and fostering innovation is what we need. And it is easy to say, but it's not so easy to implement, because being innovative, being creative means exploring something new. So we can try and we can fail. We don't have all the answers. And this is what we should encourage each other and really collaborate in this direction, and do not be afraid of not being always right or not doing everything perfect. And now we have also financial resources here in place for green recovery. So and the whole agenda around that. So the time is absolutely right. Let me just briefly touch the Circular Economy Action Plan. It was interesting enough that it has been introduced just before the corona crisis in March 2020. And I'm joking that it is a kind of a cookbook, you know, because all the ingredients that are needed for this successful circular transition are perfectly described in this document. So you have been talking already about the value chains that are important for Norway, and I rather call them even value systems, because it's really about finding the right partners in the whole system, going out of the silos and looking for new opportunities. So just to mention a few here that were mentioned before, construction and buildings, food, water, nutrition, textiles, electronics, and so on. So everything is very well described in the Circular Economy Action Plan, and I'm strongly recommending everyone to take a look. It's easy to read and to find inspiration, but not only inspiration, also the way how to move forward with partners. And here I come to our Circular Economy Stakeholder Platform in Brussels. We have 24 members, and we are already collaborating also with you, despite the fact that you are not a part of EU, but we really foster collaboration with countries elsewhere as well. Just briefly to touch the Slovenian case, as mentioned before, our journey was a little bit special and unique in a way that there was not a lot of money allocated for that. But there was a strong will and wish to do something what might become a kind of a guideline for our circular transition. And the document as such has been introduced in 2018 with one very, let's say, key element. This is the circular triangle, showing how important it is to connect circular economy as a model that refers particularly to the business, with circular culture based on citizens as the core, and circular change as the whole transitional process where the policy making is of crucial importance. And we have also found out which are those systems that are where the biggest potential lies. So in Slovenia, it was food systems, forest-based value chains, manufacturing industry, and mobility. So it is not that the others do not count, but there is the most potential, similar as you did now in Norway. So now we are working with other countries, and it is super exciting. So with Serbia, their national roadmap, Chile, completely different story in Latin America, Montenegro, tiny country in Western Balkans. So to conclude with what I have opened, what counts is really the journey and what we learn while we are collaborating on this journey. And this way, we can live the life that is forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Ladea. It's really inspiring to hear. Now, you refer to the Circular Action Plan as the cookbook, but then it all comes down to getting the chefs working. And you mentioned that the process is more important to than the documents. So can you give us some key takeaways as to how to spread engagement and competence?
Yeah, what we have learned actually that the role of the orchestrators is of great importance. Sometimes it is easier if this is someone who is coming from outside, because then you don't have any insight into the previous relations, interests, and so on. So then you can really enable the space where different interests can be put on the table. And that is what we should not be afraid of. Right now in Chile, for example, when we are working online, like we are doing right now, it is so interesting where you have mining industry, for example. We know that this is not the most circular industry on the globe. But of course, we cannot say just close down everything. We should take a look and explore how this industry can collaborate with others. And this dialogue, nourishing the dialogue and looking for the solutions together, that is what can bring us forward, and not being locked in the silos.
Thank you. And thank you so much for logging on.
Thank you very much. All the best.
Thank you. Now, our final speaker. We have now heard the European perspective. Now we're going to zoom in to a single country and to our neighbor, Finland. Kari Härlevi. He is currently leading the circular economy focus area at Sitra, who's the Finnish Innovation Fund, and involved in creating the Finnish roadmap. And although we in Norway hate to lose for the Swedes, we love to learn from the Finns. So now we want to hear from you. Kari, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Great.
Hello, Oslo.
Hello, Oslo. We are ready to hear the learning points from the Finnish expert.
Very good. Thank you very much for the opportunity. So I came to establish the circular economy area for Sitra in 2014. So it's been an exciting road for many years now in Finnish context. And I will share you some of the experiences that we have gained. But first of all, for those who don't know who we are as an institution, so Sitra is a Finnish think tank under the Finnish Parliament, around 50 years old. So we are very independent. Our fund size is around 800 million euros. And we use only the returns of the endowment capital, which is around 30 to 40 million euros. So it's really a kind of evergreen fund. And circular economy is one of the biggest areas of our operation. We started from the with McKinsey to map the biggest business opportunities for Finland back in 2014 and really looked from the material and the business point of view, competitiveness point of view. But gradually we moved to more like the social aspects of circular economy and employment and these kind of things that are, at the end of the day, very important for the society. So I just listed a couple of things from our perspective that why roadmap is really important. Of course, like Laia mentioned, there needs to be already pioneering countries, solutions in order to show what could be done. And that's obviously a starting point for every country who's taking this road. For our side, it is really a great opportunity, as was demonstrated with the data and analysis with the McKinsey, for coming 5 to 10 years for Finland. So in that sense, there is the business case there. And from Sitra's point of view, as a kind of a think to tank for Finland, the idea was really to create a shared mindset for country and invite other stakeholders to work with us. And that has been done in last 5-6 years of time with the roadmap's helps. And of course, in the kind of concrete level with different pilots that we have already ourselves as well funded as well. But it's really about, as also Laria pointed out, a collaboration and orchestrating different stakeholders. And that is maybe one of the exciting part, because otherwise you end up being in different silos. There was also in your studies earlier this morning mentioned that circular economy is a tool to mitigate climate change. And there's a big leap and big gap that we have to also in Finland to make happen here. But I'd like to also point out that we are also looking at not only the climate aspects, but also the biodiversity point of view as well, which is, of course, an important part when we think about the big picture of potential circular economy. So basically, we also did a kind of lifestyle test for Finland, and 1 million tests have been made in Finland. And we also know that most Finns are for circular economy. So there's a good kind of large shoulders to move ahead with these topics. But it's not all positive. We are on track, but still Finns are producing a lot of waste. And there are governmental silos that has to be kind of get rid of. But there is a quite good private-public collaboration, in my opinion, in a small country like Finland. But on the other hand, just to kind of boost the innovation side, we should look beyond energy efficiency and reducing waste type of things. So there has to be more holistic business models. And like there was one speaker who talked about the employment side and the just and fair transition, I think that is a key when we think really about the shifts within the society. And we also work in that space to understand where the jobs created and where they're lost. But there are some positive signs from our work as well to show that the systemic change is possible. We started early on by investing and really put an effort in the education system. So basically now, more than 70,000 students are learning about circular economy, not as a kind of separate silo topic, but it's integrated in the curriculum in different levels of education system. In fact, globally, Finnish effort is the biggest one. Of course, for 5 million people, it's quite a lot, but we are really pushing this side. So it's investing in the future so that we only have circular economy natives for Finland. The other part of the roadmap is really to look at the listed here. So we can go from state administration to citizen level, and obviously industries and cities and municipalities are important as well. If I look at these different levels, I already mentioned, and in your forum have been mentioned, the state kind of collaboration. And that has to be quite extensive. As we know, if you go from education to kind of businesses and everything in between, so it has to be really seamless process. On the other hand, in the cities, I think there's a lot of potential, but not that much happening yet. There could be better public procurement processes, for example, in the city level to be used. If I look at the industry level, there we worked with industry level players, federation technologies and chemical industries to provide playbooks. And it's really glad that the Nordic Innovation is working with us to provide that kind of tools also in the Nordic level. So I think there is a great potential for Nordic collaboration in the business sector as well. And obviously, I think in many Nordic countries, we see that sharing, renting, and reusing are becoming more and more popular. So there is also the kind of end user demand. So as a final point, what we are currently doing, many things, of course, we are working with the recovery part for Finland, so integrating circular economy in the recovery plans. And that is not happening quite a lot internationally currently, so we are hoping to help that out in our country. But also, we are making the roadmap, circular economy roadmap experiences public by providing a guidebook, how to make a roadmap, and it will be published in September in the World Circular Economy Forum online side event that we are having. So welcome to join the forum as well. But those were the things that I wanted to share with you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Kari. It's very inspiring to see how you involve not only decision makers, but even down to school children. So it sounds very exciting, but what are the main Finnish challenges left unsolved?
Well, one thing is, of course, to make sure that the small and medium-sized companies understand the potential and can apply these principles. We know that around 25% of the biggest companies in Finland have integrated circular economy, at least in the strategy level, but in the kind of broader impact in Finnish society, we need to make sure that the bigger sectors and the smaller companies also take these on board.
Great, thank you. And we are excited to hear that you are open to more Nordic collaboration. So perhaps we'll see you soon. Okay.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much.